I was told to bang it hard so they could hear it inside. But so that we could be officially underway. Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Kelvin Ogilvie, a senator from Nova Scotia and chair of the Senate Standing Committee on Social Affairs, Science and Technology. And it's my pleasure to welcome you here to the committee's panel discussion titled Dementia in Canada, Solutions for a Looming Crisis. Et bonjour à tous. C'est un plaisir pour moi de vous...
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure for me to welcome you to this important discussion on dementia. I'm looking forward to hearing your views on this issue.
At the beginning, to introduce the members of the panel. First of all, my fellow senators, Art Eggleton, who's deputy chair of our committee and represents Ontario, and Carolyn Stewart Olsen, who is a member of our steering committee and represents New Brunswick. We also have Dr. Antoine Hakim, who is over there, an emeritus professor in neurology from the University of Ottawa and senior neurologist at the Ottawa Hospital. Now, next I would have hoped to have been introducing André Picard, but unfortunately the events in Quebec have caused him to have to head out there, and he has indicated he's particularly disappointed not to be here with you today. Dr. Frank Molnar is the Vice President of the Canadian Geriatric Society. Michael Duncan is a retired Navy commander and has recently been diagnosed with dementia and is here with his wife, Catherine Duncan, and she's here going to help us take on the issue of the caregiver role, which, as you know from our report, we consider to be a very critical part of all of this. And Professor Linda Garcia, who's Professor and Vice Dean from the Faculty of Health Sciences at the University of Ottawa. Also joining us from the Senate is Senator Watt, who is here with us, and he has some knowledge of these issues as well from a personal experience. So, this panel, by the way, is the first of its type for a Senate committee, and has arisen out of the Senate's movement forward in developing a modern communication approach to its reports. We believe the Senate does good work in general on these reports. They don't usually find their way before the public in the same way that some other things do. And this one has is an event that our report has gotten a great deal of attention, and working with the leadership of our communications people felt that this might be a very good thing to do as a follow-up to our report and timely with the end of Alzheimer's Month. So that is the motivation for this. And I want to acknowledge our colleagues in communications at the Senate for their efforts in putting this event together. Now, our report has come out, and we continue to engage with Canadians and raise awareness about the impact of dementia in Canadian society. And as you are aware, those of you here, senators have called on Canadians to support the committee's recent report and its major recommendations, urging the creation of a national dementia strategy. On Twitter and Facebook, Canadians from all walks of life and from all across the country have retweeted and shared this call to action. Some Canadians have even shared their personal experiences. Now, our report, which was entitled Dementia in Canada, a National Strategy for Dementia-Friendly Communities, was tabled in the Senate last November. We hope it is just the beginning of an important dialogue about this urgent issue. It is a conversation that must continue, and we don't in any way want to imply that we have failed to recognize the tremendous work done by many organizations and researchers in this country, with the Alzheimer's Society of Canada being one of our major partners in developing our report and so on. But it's our report, and we're trying to get all of these issues out there as much as possible. So We had identified and recognized the imminent public health challenges Dementia poses in Canada, and we made 29 recommendations. They covered a number of specific recommendations, but lumping them together, they included improving the supports available to dementia patients and their caregivers, helping provincial governments provide more spaces in long-term care facilities, and increasing research funding. Additionally, the report described ways to encourage Canadian communities to become more dementia-friendly in the actual communities, so that people diagnosed with dementia can continue to live independently much longer than they do now in general, and so that they can live with dignity while they fight a disease notorious for robbing them of it. What we've done today is attempted to, through the panel, to discuss four particular topics in more detail. The four of them are the following: how to get solid information after you or a loved one is diagnosed with dementia, what to expect, and how to deal with it. Our second topic today is how to support informal caregivers and home and community care. Thirdly, we'll talk about improved training for healthcare providers and integration of health services for dementia patients. And our fourth topic will be, the panel will discuss enhanced social acceptance and integration of dementia patients and their caregivers, including greater access to assisted living facilities. Now, for each topic, I will call on a different member of our committee to introduce the topic and to start the discussion. And after some brief remarks, we'll open it up to all panelists, the panelists up here, to share their experience on that topic. We will see how that goes, and we will end that and move on to the next topic. As moderator, I'll follow that and end it at an appropriate amount of time. And at the end of the four topics discussed by the panel, we will open up the floor to a question and answer session from the audience. And during that time, audience members will be invited to pose any dementia-related question to any member of the panel. So, we're ready to go. I'm going to introduce the first topic for us today, and that is topic number one. One of the concerns of our Senate committee that our Senate committee heard while studying dementia in Canada was the isolation people feel when they are first diagnosed with dementia. It's traumatizing, devastating news. One of the first challenges is where to turn for information, how to deal with it, and how do you start processing the news so you can understand what to expect for yourself and your family. I'd like to share with you a story from one of our witnesses who appeared before us in our study. And the experience at that first diagnosis is different across the country, but in general, this story, we felt, puts it right in perspective. She said, "I went to the doctor and was diagnosed with the early stages of dementia. And essentially, I felt that I left there and was sent home to close the door and spend the rest of my life away from society." She said, "I received very little information at that point." She said, and this was a nurse. She had been a nurse in life. She said, "Had I been diagnosed as having had a stroke or heart disease, immediately a whole set of support teams would have gone into place to provide me with everything from what to expect, how to behave, that is exercise, diet, and so on, and the support services available to help me and my family deal with this. I receive none of that." And by the way, just to check, I Googled dementia yesterday just to follow up on what's there. 12 million hits. The average person has no way of sorting through that kind of situation. So, our first panelist that I'm going to ask to start this off, in each case I'm going to invite someone to start off the discussion. And I'm going to ask Dr. Frank Molnar, who is Vice President of the Canadian Geriatric Society, to talk us through these initial steps. Frank.
Thank you. The topic is well framed. It clearly highlights that there are different types of information that are provided by different organizations at different stages in the journey. And we've certainly mapped out the stages in the journey in a subway model that we can share later on. It's a fairly complex journey that people enter into. So I'll start at the beginning. To even go for a diagnosis, one needs to be aware of the signs of possible dementia. We therefore need media campaigns such as the Bell Let's Talk campaign for mental health, or the Signs of Stroke campaign, both of which were brilliant. The Public Health Agency of Canada is well positioned to take this on. Once a diagnosis has been established, then physicians, nurse practitioners, and nurses need to be able to link newly diagnosed persons with dementia and their caregivers to a reliable source of information and counseling, such as the Alzheimer Society, via the First Link program, another leading best practice. The First Link, however, requires more funding to grow and evolve. As an example, we still rely on paper First Link referral forms, which physicians like myself can't find in their offices, and then we send them in by fax or even put them in the mail. What we need to do is modernize the program by funding a national electronic referral platform, perhaps using a domain name such as firstlink.ca, which is still available today. A platform which allows clinicians across Canada to electronically refer a patient to their local Alzheimer Society chapter, perhaps using their postal code, and which also permits the addition of multiple family email addresses to facilitate transfer of information and education opportunities to multiple family members simultaneously. As dementia progresses, caregivers' information needs change dramatically. They no longer only need information on the signs, symptoms, and course of dementia. They also need information on how to address emergency situations, how to address issues that caregivers tell me result in caregiver burnout and premature placement, including urinary incontinence, responsive behaviors, lack of sleep, and falls. They need information on advanced care planning and ultimately when to switch to and how to access palliative care so their loved one can die with dignity in the setting of their choice, which is often their home. These information needs exceed what one organization such as the Alzheimer Society can provide on its own and require the input of specialists in geriatric psychiatry, care of the elderly, and geriatric medicine. The Canadian Geriatric Society and the Canadian Academy of Geriatric Psychiatry have the expertise to provide such information and would be an integral part of any future Canadian partnership to address dementia. My final point relates to home care, the eyes on the ground, the people who come to the home. We desperately need dedicated dementia home care. In the past, we had this in the Ottawa region, and they provided critical support in terms of information on system navigation and crisis prevention. The experience since has clearly demonstrated that home care coordinators, no matter how skilled and caring they are, do not have the training and expertise to provide this information if they are not trained in dementia. So we've moved from dementia home care teams to more generalist teams, and it's not working. Dementia is just too complicated. We need the Canadian Home Care Association to commit to dementia as a national priority and to promote the development of dedicated dementia home care in every province and territory so that the information can be brought to families and their caregivers and persons with dementia. Thank you.
Now, who else on the committee would like to come in on this and further flesh this out? Linda?
The point that I wanted to break, and I'm totally in agreement with everything that Frank has said, but one of the things that we hear a lot is from the caregivers in the area of diagnosis is to listen to what the caregiver has to say about what the changes that they're noticing at home, for instance, especially in the early phases. For instance, some of the tests that we have right now are dated in a way, and when we look, we know that with dementia we can have major changes in function, but some of the functions that we're evaluating on some of these tests, for instance, using a rotary phone or things like that, are not things that we do anymore. But having access to using a bank machine or these kinds of things, these are subtle signs that sometimes caregivers will pick up. And as we've moved towards person-centered care, I think our healthcare professionals have focused very much on the person with dementia and excluded the caregiver. And caregivers tell us this all the time when they go into hospitals and things like that. They're kind of excluded, and they'll go and take a history, let's say, from the person with dementia when we know there might be some gaps in the memory. So I would stress that I think we need very much to include the caregiver in the whole diagnosis process as well, and consider things like culture and differences in how we look at things, to see they will be able to pick out some of those subtle differences that maybe the person with dementia might not be able to say or recognize.
Mm-hmm.
So I would absolutely support what you've heard from Drs. Garcia and Molnar, but also back it up a little bit to talk about the importance of early diagnosis, because someone could have been living with the subtle effects of dementia for a couple years, wondering what was going on, but without that diagnosis, it really keeps them perhaps in prison and in their own inability to understand what's happening with them. So the importance of early diagnosis is really important. And then the importance of a First Link program, a program like that that will the Alzheimer's Society is really offering in community across the country, really important to then offer a world of care and support to people who have received that early diagnosis. So important to get the diagnosis in the first place, then important to hook people up to the care and support that's available. And I would say also bringing it back to one of the key recommendations from the Senate report on the need for a national dementia strategy for Canada, because we do know that there is good work that's going on across the country, but we don't have any place where it's all pulled together. So we want to make sure that every Canadian, no matter where they live in Canada, has the access to the same kind of early diagnosis and then care, support, and information once they get that diagnosis.
Thank you, Debbie. Just before moving on, I think Senator Eggleton wanted to get Frank to clarify a point that...
I picked up on the words, general teams are not working. Can you explain that a little bit more? It sounds like you're suggesting that maybe GPs, general practitioners,
are not. I'll back up and take another run at that. So in the Ottawa region, we had dedicated dementia home care teams years ago, and they performed an invaluable service. They really were able to counsel and guide families going through this experience. That was felt to not be a priority. Those home care teams were closed, and now home care is sort of a generalist approach. So. Home care coordinator has to deal with all sorts of diseases and situations with no specialization. That just doesn't work. So the families are not getting the help they need. This is not unique to the dementia. This might be transferable to congestive heart failure, to any complex diseases. The generalist home care approach does not work, but there's a huge potential to save money by building that in, having those specialized team become the eyes and ears on the ground and linking up with primary care and specialists to avert crises from happening.
This is not just related to diagnosis, it's related, you mentioned home care specifically. What would you see? We need to reestablish these specialized committees, is what you're saying?
I think we need dedicated dementia home care teams with care coordinators who are trained in dementia care, who understand the caregiver issue, the person's
issues. Both the social
issues,
and the health care.
The social and health care, because information on dementia is really massive, and you can't digest it all at once. You digest it in little chunks as you're going through the process. So you have to have people that are in touch with people with dementia and their families on an ongoing basis who can provide that information and perhaps relink them back to the Alzheimer's Society, linked them to the family physician, but our home care coordinators are the eyes and ears on the ground in the home.
And do you think this could work in remote areas as well? Because
I think this would be particularly important in remote areas.
Okay.
Catherine, would you like to come in on this?
Yes, please. I agree with everything that all the professionals have mentioned. With a personal experience with Michael and I, it was myself noticing changes in Michael that weren't typical. And luckily for me, I was already aware of the Alzheimer's office in the Purley in Ottawa, because I have a younger brother due to strokes is living there permanently. So both of us separately quickly went and got triaged by the staff there, found out the information. Of course, Michael was not as embracing and warming to it, which took about another year, and that's okay.
But I noticed, for example, we're downhill skiers, and he down in Aspen couldn't find his ski clothes. He just couldn't get things together. So then I would do all that thinking this is not like him. So we're younger. We're only in our early 60s. We're very proactive. And thank you to the Alzheimer's Ottawa office because they gave us the platform. The at-home dedicated that Dr. Frank has mentioned would be awesome to have. I just see that extremely value-added because there isn't a program, and we wouldn't have known where to go or what to do if I hadn't known about the Pearly and the Alzheimer's office.
Thank you. Tony, do you want to add on this one?
Thank you. I've been thinking about the nurse example that you gave at the beginning of the talk, where she goes to her physician and the physician says, you have early dementia, and she goes home and feels that life has come to an end. It's very important at that point to remember that there are many potential contributors to dementia, and some of them can not only be prevented, but they can also be interrupted and even reversed in some circumstances. The genetically inherited dementias, the dementia is likely to appear at a fairly early age in the 50s and 55, but in the great majority of dementia cases, for the older demographics, which is really what we're worried about here, vascular disease makes an enormous contribution to the dementia. And so that nurse, what we owed her at that point is to say, here is why we think you are losing your marbles slowly. And here are the things that you could do, perhaps to either control it, or even here are the efforts you can make to reverse this, to regain some of your cognitive ability, some of your memory functions. So I just want to, you know, my only contribution to this meeting, and I'm very, very grateful to the Senate and to you, Senator Ogilvie, for bringing this to the national level of consciousness. But what we need to remember is that dementia is not a necessary companion to old age. Dementia can be interrupted, even sometimes reversed, if we know why.
Thank you, Tony. And by the way, I've had the good fortune to be able to view an advanced copy of a book that Tony has just completed. Hopefully it will get out very soon on this area, and I can assure you it is going to make a real contribution to our general understanding in this area. He is, as you know, a renowned neurologist and deals specifically with the issue of the vascular aspect of it that he's just covered specifically. Before I move on to and ask Senator Eggleton to take up topic two, I wanted to pick up on one element that has come up, and you mentioned specifically, Frank, that is, how can we set it up so that people can get quick access to reliable information? And you gave one potential model, which I think could well work. In our report, as you know, we suggested that PHAC be the Public Health Association of Canada, be a source. They have a mandate, in fact, for that very issue. But on their web page, we did not find it met what we consider to be the mandate in this area, certainly, with regard to a best practices website. And it seems to me that, by the way, we've produced a report on obesity. Many of the issues around communication, we found the same things there. And it seemed to us that the public health agency, we need some source where Canadians can go and try to get best practice in a range of major illnesses that they deal with. And that we felt that should be the logical place. And we have been urging them with some vigor to use their opportunity on their webpage to be a conduit for this sort of thing. But the kinds of things you suggested, Frank, in terms of how to an individual can not only get the information, but through their postal code to be able to get it right at their home province would be a good addition. Art, would you
Okay, this is topic number two. It's greater support for informal caregivers. A few words have already been touched on the importance of that. Also home care, community care. As the committee studied dementia last year, we learned about how much incredible work is being done by informal caregivers. I think the figure was something on the average of 8 hours or so a day. And of course, there's no doubt that these people who are very often a spouse or a child of someone living with dementia face burnout themselves. And we talked about respite care, for example, for the caregivers and tax means of helping to overcome the financial aspects of caregiving, because it frequently does mean a person works less, needs more time off. So we made several recommendations along those lines. We're going to now get into this discussion, being led by Linda Garcia. Linda is professor and vice dean of governance and secretary of the Faculty of Health and Science here at the University of Ottawa. And then we'll open it up for 15 minutes of discussion. I have Debbie Benskowski and Dr. Molnar, who've already indicated they want to get in on that. And so we'll start with Linda, go to them, and anybody else after that.
That's good. So first of all, I have to congratulate you on the document, because I think that, you know, I mean, it's always easy to pick a document apart and look at the holes and say, you know, you missed this and you need to do that. But, you know, I think you asked a lot of really good people for advice, and I think there's a lot of things in there that are really worthwhile. So what I'm going to focus on are some of the things that, you know, I want to put emphasis on and maybe just have us think a little bit more about the support for caregivers. So there's a couple, there's two parts to this theme. One of them has to deal with the informal caregivers, and the other one has to do with community, so a little bit more on the home care. One of the points that I want to strengthen is the fact that respite care is for the caregiver. It is for the person with dementia, but it really is supposed to be for the person to get respite. And we have not a lot of information about, you know, what people are doing when they get their time off. And I think that one of the things, as I watched my colleague in front here, and so I think one of the analogies I'd like to use here is, you know, if you have a big weight on your shoulders, and, you know, we do it with heart, but at the same time, it does carry weight. If you just take that weight off, it doesn't mean that it hasn't left its mark, you know? So just to take that weight off and say, you know, I'm going to go and take care of your husband or your mother or whomever, and you go have fun, it's like, well, no, you know, like, I'm exhausted, I have this weight still on my arm, and to boot, it has to do a lot with your expectations and how you feel that that place that you're leaving your loved one, do you feel confident in that or not? So you go home and you may be worrying and continuing. So respite, we need to look at it for the caregiver. What are we doing for the caregiver? What kinds of programs can we put in there? And how can we make sure that they feel that it meets the expectations and that they feel the trust? That's one point I wanted to bring up. The other point I wanted to bring up and get us thinking about is the issue around, can we put the spouse, the daughter, the son back into caregiving? We, all of a sudden, when you become a caregiver, you're a caregiver. It's like somehow somebody forgot that I'm a wife or I'm a child, an adult child, and that I don't really want to caregive or be this person's nurse. I want to be their spouse. I want to be their daughter. I want to take mom shopping. I want to have fun and listen to music with my husband. And, you know, and those are the kinds of pieces I think we need to do. So when I look at some of the recommendations in the report around, hey, guys, you're doing a good job, you caregivers. I will get you to have time off so that you can do more. And maybe what I want to say is, you know what, can we just have somebody do some of that stuff for me, and then I'll spend the time listening to music with my husband. And I actually, when I go to work, it kind of gives me a bit of a break, really. So, but I can't go and have a break if if, you know, I know that my husband's not well at home or not well taken care of, or I don't have the supports. So I would like us to put the spouse, the daughter, and the son back, and I'm stressing son, because we're starting to hear more and more, although there are many more women that caregive, and it is a women's issue, it is becoming also a men's issue. And the sons are not necessarily seeing the same kinds of support, and we've heard that oftentimes from caregivers as well. So I'd like us to remember that as well. The other point that I wanted, two other points, is one around volunteers and volunteer support. We have a great tradition in Canada of volunteers, and we have we stretch the volunteer support, and volunteer support can be had from different levels. And one of the levels that I have not seen very much in the report is youth. There are many models around the world around youth being giving some support to seniors. We have to fight ageism. We have to fight. You know, we want to get more people. I know that Tony's going to be talking about education. We want to get them interested in working with seniors. One of the best ways is to start getting them involved, have volunteer programs where they are giving help and being properly trained so that they can get interested in supporting. The last point that I want to make, and as much as I totally am 110% beside my colleague here in support of all of the things that we want to do around home care, I think part of the reason, one of the discourse that I would like us to see is change, is this doom and gloom of people who feel that long-term care is like I'm somehow going to be sending my loved one to a jail, and at all costs, I do not want to go there. And we're making people feel guilty about sometimes wanting to do that just because they're at the end of their rope. And I can totally understand that feeling. At the same time, I think the thinking needs, the discourse and the culture needs to change so that what we're looking at are long-term care homes that are continuations of home and not continuations of hospitals. So in other words, you get home care, you get that support, and that it's not an end-all be-all. You don't go there to die. You can go there and come home sometimes. You can go have a more flexible system. There are models. Japan has done some of these. Let's look at these new models. Let's pick and choose. And our thermometer for all of these different, when you're looking at all this array, the thermometer, we talk about listening to the person with dementia and the families, and when we talk about people who live with dementia, we are talking about the person who has the disease and the caregivers. So let's listen to, that'll be our thermometer. We need to pick and choose. What do they need? So this is what I need to say about home care.
Good. Thank you. Now we'll pick up on that, and I'll go to Debbie Benskowski, who is the Chief Operating Officer of the Alzheimer's Society of Canada.
Thank you, Senator. So, thank you, Linda. I think that was a great summary of really what's important for people to remain in the community as long as possible, but also recognizing the challenges in the long-term care industry and public perception of long-term care as well, because we do know that probably 80 to 90% of people will die with dementia will die in a long-term care home. So let's make it as wonderful as we possibly can. The Alzheimer's Society hopes that having a national dementia strategy will help to make sure that people with dementia can live well and remain in their homes and their communities for as long as possible, and that every Canadian has access to the same standard of care and support no matter where they live in Canada. So I would say remember keeping people at home and in their communities for as long as possible is actually very cost effective. But in order to do that, we have to make sure that the proper supports are in place. We have to make sure that there's respite care for caregivers who are providing that kind of care, whether they be a wife, a daughter, a son, a grandchild, whatever. We have to make sure that those supports are available, and that we need to work collaboratively. So we need to work together, all levels of government, the federal government, government, provincial governments, civil society, healthcare providers, researchers, and people with dementia and their caregivers, to find affordable solutions that are respectful of choice, of dignity, and can help people to live well as long as possible with their disease in Canada. But integral to this is we need to provide caregivers with respite, as we already heard, and with help in training. Our current healthcare workforce is really not prepared to provide dementia care. There's a desperate need for more training, and this needs to be embedded in the curriculum of all university and college programs and provided to professional groups and direct service providers. The moment a diagnosis is made, family members, the majority of which are women, automatically step into this role. And it's a Herculean task because dementia is chronic, progressive, and eventually fatal. The progression of the disease, as we know, takes a huge toll on caregivers who will eventually have to provide 24-hour care and tend to the person's most basic needs. The biggest challenge is avoiding caregiver burnout when a caregiver can no longer perform their role. I've heard so many people say to me, both my parents died of dementia. My one parent died of the disease and the other died of caring for the person with the disease. So caregiving puts tremendous pressure on families, financial pressures, as well as just the physical demands of care. If we can provide home and community care with the right amount of supervision and assistance, we may be able to postpone or even avoid the need for people to move into an institutional care setting, which most people say they don't want to move into because there are so many problems that are associated with it. But at the end of the day, we know that we'll never be able to build enough long-term care beds to take care of everyone who has this disease. So it's incumbent on us to make sure that we do provide the supports and the care to people so that they can stay in their communities as long as possible.
Thank you. Dr. Molnar is going to come in on this one as well.
So I've heard quite a few brilliant suggestions. I'm going to focus on the two that really jumped out at me. Number one was involving youth, involving our children. During the hearings that led up to this report, we did hear the idea of having seniors come to schools to present. I think that's a nice starting point. In my son's public elementary school, they actually go to seniors' residences to visit seniors. And when he first came home, I was curious. I was a little nervous to hear how that might have gone, and he found it to be a very, very positive experience that unfortunately wasn't followed up on as a program. But certainly all the children that I spoke to and he spoke to really found that positive, and you could see that slowly graduating over the years from visiting, from social interactions to actually helping in the residences and developing a different social conscience. So I think there's some sort of graduated exposure that could be envisioned. The other point that jumped out at me was putting the daughter and son back into caregiving. Sometimes there are limitations. We're limited by distance. We're not in the same city as our parents, limited by work, limited by other family responsibilities, having children of our own. So that leads me to wonder whether there are other ways that daughters and sons can contribute if they can't get over those hurdles, including tax-deductible contributions to their parents' respite, residences, or any services that might be needed if their parents are dealing with dementia. And that could actually help offload some of the pressures for long-term care, because a lot of people go into long-term care because they can't afford a retirement home. But if we have tax-deductible donations from the extended family, that might be a way to offset that pressure.
Can I ask both you and Professor Garcia about youth a little bit more? Because are there any particularly best practices, good practices? You mentioned school. Is that the best way to get young people understanding dementia a little bit better, going on an excursion from the school into a senior's home? Or are there other models? Now, we did hear, the only connection I recall hearing with youth and people with dementia was from the indigenous population. They apparently do have a good connection between their youth and those older people. So, do you have any particular programs or models that we should be advancing?
No particular program or model, but I would propose that these exposure programs be really focused on developing respect for seniors, not just people with dementia, to get to know seniors as people, and then seeing how they deal with any of the conditions that they have to deal with. It's not necessarily dementia focused, it's broader.
Okay, Professor Garcia.
So I think there are different levels and there are different goals, and I think it's a win-win situation. So there are programs, for instance, in the UK where university students actually jog to seniors. So they run and they go and get them stuff. So if they have errands to run or whatever, they'll go and get them their errands and bring them home. So you're fighting, you know, exercise and so on, and you're getting service and so on. We are just finishing up a study right now where we had university students go into long-term care homes, and I have to tell you, it was one of those life-changing moments for me, because I expected them to go in, and it was one-on-one time for every week they gave 6 hours for 2 years in these homes. They developed a relationship with the person in the long-term care home. They learned about them. They knew what to do. And you know what? The win-win situation. If you're a person that's had children and grandchildren, it's part of your meaningful activities to take care of someone, okay? And what I would tell my students is, let these residents take care of you. It's part of their meaningful activities of life. So it gave meaning to the people we're talking people with advanced dementia in long-term care homes, taking care. The students would say, I feel like I'm getting more out of this than I'm giving back. It would give them a break from their exams. They weren't allowed to use their phones or anything. It was, we taught them about mindfulness, stay in the middle, stay in the time. And the residents were taking care and asking them about their exams and helping them. And everything was about the moment. They learned a lot about it. They respected. They were impressed with the resilience that the residents had in terms of, despite all these things that were going on in their bodies, they were still be able to smile and take part in some activities. They were able to take them outside and do things that they wouldn't normally be doing on one-on-one. So I think there's different things at different levels that can happen, but there are many different things out there that we can go and tap on. But I think it's a really good orientation for us to help people change their minds about what dementia is all about.
Great. We're really out of time, but we'll get to a couple of quick comments.
I'll save my comment for my section.
Okay. Yes, Catherine Duncan.
And I just have a quick comment on the school. We had thought, brainstorming with the Alzheimer's people, that if we could go into the schools, the person with dementia and the caregiver for story time, reading, sitting on the floors, whatever, for arts and crafts, that would involve or bring everybody together, but we go to them. So whether that's seniors or anybody, we thought that might be a nice program that if we could get going with some of the local schools, we happen to have five around us, that, yes, it puts smiles on all our faces with children. And for example, Michael's son is in Toronto, his daughter's in Western Australia, so we don't have family here in the city. But that nurturing and children and that feel good, and his eyes just brighten up when we do see and hear children.
Thank you. Just before I pass it on to Senator Stewart Olsen, a couple of quick things on the comments that have come up. There's recently an example in Fredericton, New Brunswick, where they have set up one day a month where the caregivers can bring their cared for to a center, a kind of cafe style, from the memory cafe kind of stuff. And then the caregiver can go off for the whole day and just have a complete day to themselves. It doesn't cover all the issues you pointed out in terms of need, but it's apparently having a tremendous impact in that area. Finally, the issue around volunteers came up over times in our discussions. This is a tricky area in this particular disease issue because you have the issue of people who are, A, vulnerable, so you have to be very careful with volunteer approaches that you dealt with involving schools and things like that are easier to control. And then there is, of course, the issue as the disease progresses, the need to not have too many different faces appearing all the time within the overall issue. So just wanted to point out that the volunteer aspect in this area is one that there are international examples, but we're way down the curve yet in developing them overall.
Prove you wrong, though.
Well, hopefully. But we know in society, you can read the newspapers and know that you have to be careful when you're in the realm of volunteers. Senator Stewart Olsen.
Thank you, and thank you all for being here. Topic number three, we're going to discuss improved training for healthcare providers and the integration of our health services for people with dementia. And I find it's particularly necessary. I live in a rural area, New Brunswick is very high population of seniors, and we're a very rural province. Now, when you talk about training people, I see on a day-to-day basis, and New Brunswick is very progressive in what we're trying to do, but our people, our home care providers and people who go into homes, paid minimum wage, no training, and I can't really see very much supervision. So I will just kind of leave that with you, and I'd like to call on Dr. Hakim, a professor emeritus in neurology at the University of Ottawa and senior neurologist at the Ottawa Hospital, to begin the discussion on this issue.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you. We really are facing a very significant challenge in improving the awareness of my colleagues in various specialties and subspecialties about the potential contributors to dementia as we get older and how to deal with them. We must appreciate, as I have said, that the brain that you have in old age is the one you nurtured all your life. The script for dementia can get written fairly early, depending on how big of a smoker I am, how much I drink, how much TV I watch by sitting and not moving. And there are so many issues that can contribute to that very first diagnosis of the physician saying to the patient, I think you have early dementia. What do we then do? What does the physician do with all these lifestyle issues that he or she really cannot influence very much? How much more information do we need to convey to my colleagues? That there are things that can be done. And even despite all their best goodwill to help, the situation of early dementia is often so overwhelming and so multifactorial that I've always maintained that what we need to have is a healthy brain clinic that would not just have clinicians contributing to it, but also social workers. Also other people who are going to understand lifestyle issues. We have, in this country, had quite significant success with decreasing smoking incidence, for instance. But think of all the things that have gone into decreasing the success we've had in decreasing smoking incidence. We made it socially unacceptable to smoke. We made it, we bombarded you with advertisements on the cigarette box that made you want to puke before you would pick up the first cigarette to light. And I can go on and on. It takes coordinated effort when we're convinced that something is bad for us. Clinicians cannot do that. No matter how willing or committed they are, this is much bigger than that. But when you go have your eyes checked and the ophthalmologist looks at your eye, he sees vascular disease in your retina. What does he do about that? Nothing. He may tell you to go see your family doctor. But what does the family? So the family doctor says, yes, you do have early vascular disease in your brain. Here are the six things you need to avoid. Strokes, you've mentioned them. 60% of patients who suffer a stroke will become demented within a matter of months. But we've learned that strokes is not just those big ones that make you paralyze or lose your speech. There's also these covert strokes, small strokes that occur in your brain. You know, the patient comes to me and says, my brain is in a fog, doctor, and I'm only 35 years old. Well, the MRI shows four of these tiny strokes that the patient never felt. Well, where are they coming from? Your brain weighs only 2% of your body weight, but consumes 25% of the energy. It is incredibly dependent on its blood supply. Those white spots on the MRI scans are little blood vessels that have blocked off. Well, now what you owe me after you've told me that I have four of these in my brain is, what do I do about it? Well, so there is a need for communication, which is what this panel is about, for communication and integration of the information that comes from various subspecialties. And please don't tell the family physician or the geriatrician, who's already overwhelmed with their responsibilities, you take care of this patient's blood pressure, smoking, obesity, sedentary existence, and the fact that they don't move around, and they drink too much, and they, I'm only a family physician. I can't take care of all this. So we need to come up with additional ways of integrating all of that information. What does it mean, just to be the person who puts this on the table? What does it mean that I don't ever have to look at a geographic map anymore to know where I want to go? I don't make my brain work. What does it mean that I get in my car and sit down and push on a button and somebody in the dashboard tells me when to turn left and when to turn right? Maybe we are not activating our brains sufficiently. There are ways of making it do things that demand that it gets to work, and that, it turns out, prevents us from having dementia later on. So we need not only integration of the health services and better training to my colleague, but we need a society-level discourse about what are the things that we can do to increase, and there is plenty of evidence that that can be done, to increase our cognitive capacity in our brain.
Thank you, Dr. Hakim. I have a note that Dr. Molnar would like to join in this.
So I'll switch gears a little bit. There are a number of levels of training that we can discuss. I'll touch on two of them. One is in acute care. So I have been practicing in acute care hospitals for 25 years, and over I see dementia care falling apart in that setting. That's where things are the weakest in terms of dementia care. There would certainly be value in having Accreditation Canada consider a standard that all hospitals have a dementia and delirium plan that includes training in the care of persons with dementia, including the care of persons with dementia who are having responsive behaviors. If we do develop a national dementia plan, it should include an acute care component with, once again, training. The second point is looking at the specialists who practice dementia care, or the specialties. So those would be geriatric medicine, geriatric psychiatry, care of the elderly, and cognitive neurology. We definitely do not have enough of those specialists to help the primary care practitioners. So we need to look at the number of, we need to decide whether dementia is in fact a priority, and we need to create training spots that are proportional with the need, with societal need. We need more incentives to have them enter. We can't have people going into these dementia care specialty understanding they will earn less than if they didn't practice dementia care. So we need to look at those physician human resources issues. Those are two of many training issues that we could discuss. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Garcia?
Yes, so I'm coming from the Faculty of Health Sciences. There are other professionals as well, besides physicians and nurses and so on as well. And there are, we talked about maintaining functions, so we would add into the mix rehabilitation, professionals from rehabilitation as well. We have worked dementia, we've talked about, and I really like that phrase in the report about it being the godfather of complexity. And just because you have dementia doesn't mean you don't have arthritis and you don't have depression or you don't have other things going on with you. And it is a complex issue. So when we train, we need to have everybody come into the mix. And we need to look at it, again, centered on the individual and looking at all of these different things. So we look at, we've proposed to have a pyramid of education where you have the basic knowledge. There's public awareness, and I'm sure we're going to get to dementia friends soon, but there's public awareness around that kind of knowledge, and then as you go up and the more and more highly specialized training that we were just talking about. So I think we could look at it, for instance, personal support workers that work in long-term care. There's a big issue around transfer of information. So we need some educational resources. Quite frankly, we have a lot that are silo-specific. How do you look at falls? How do you look at dementia? How do you look at stroke? But what about somebody who has all these different things? And what about somebody when you work in some of these clinics? Maybe there's some governmental agencies who remain unnamed that might be able to help us with producing some of this educational material that would go across all of these different disorders so that people can kind of pick them out and we can use them in awareness as well. Oh, that looks a little bit like dementia maybe. And, oh, he's walking like that, but yeah, no, I'm not sure that's dementia. That could be something else. So you just a little bit of information like that, some educational material that we could use in universities, that we could use in colleges, that we can use for public awareness, that would incorporate an individual with a whole bunch of different things going on. And you have the professionals around the country that will help you with that, I'm sure.
Thank you. Sadzkowski?
Yes, thank you. So just go back to what Dr. Hakim said about it can't be the responsibility of just the family doctor or geriatrician. It has to be, in my view, has to be a collective responsibility. And so it has to be cross-disciplinary, and it has to be cross all of civil society, governments, industry, healthcare professionals, everybody. So, and then it takes me right back to why the Alzheimer's Society has been working so hard to advocate for a national dementia strategy for Canada, because we really believe that that's where this collaboration is going to happen, because all of these sectors of society need to be involved in developing a strategy so that the collective is really all aware and all bringing the expertise together in one place.
I must say that doing that is an investment. It's not a cost. It's some of the figures and the report was very clear about this. We're going to bankrupt ourselves with this issue of dementia. And yet there are some things that can be done fairly cheaply, provided we're coordinated to try to avoid this cost. Dementia is not unavoidable.
Very well put. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you. Well, just before we move on to the fourth topic on this particular issue, you will know from our report we agree entirely with the general sentiment here. And I think I should point out that we also released a report on the Canadian healthcare system as we reviewed the 2004 health accord a few years ago. And what we see is this issue is pervasive in the Canadian healthcare system. Silos. Everything is a silo. And in an area such as this, where you have people, as you indicated, dealing often with a number of comorbidities, you simply can't have isolated expertise dealing with them. I think you've enhanced that and illustrated that so well. Thank you very much in that. Okay, our final topic this afternoon is about enhancing social acceptance of dementia patients, removing the stigma associated with Alzheimer's disease and other forms of dementia, and improving access to assisted living facilities. So I want to invite Debbie Manzkowski again to lead this one off.
Thank you very much, Senator. And again, I'd just like to echo the chorus of everybody around the table and in the room today to commend all of you for the excellent work you've done on the Senate report. Thank you very much. It's great. So anyone with a brain is at risk of dementia. Dementia is a disease. It's not a normal part of aging. And I believe that if Canadians could understand this, maybe people with dementia wouldn't experience the stigma that they currently experience. We know stigma is negative stereotyping. Also, people with dementia can also be subject to ageism as well. What's ageism? Well, that's the stereotyping and discrimination against people just because of their age. So when these two things are combined, stigma and ageism, it's a lethal combination. Many of the people we hear from at the Alzheimer's Society, they say how others judge them is one of the greatest barriers to a complete and satisfying life. The Alzheimer's Society says that 3 out of 4 people are touched by dementia, and 4 out of 4 are impacted by it. What can you do? Well, we can talk about it, which we're doing today, which is why we're so grateful for this opportunity that you've provided for us. We can be aware about dementia. Are we scared? I'll bet you most people in this room would say, yep, I'm scared about it. Do we want to pretend it doesn't exist? Yes. but then it might touch us. And then it's not just someone else's disease, but it's ours too. So let's think of ways to promote social and community acceptance and help people with dementia feel welcomed in our communities, in our stores, in our banks, wherever they live in Canada. And that's what I challenge all of us today to do. One thing that the Alzheimer Society of Canada is doing in partnership with the Public Health Agency of Canada, and it's been referred to in the Senate report, is promoting social inclusion of people with dementia through our Dementia Friends Canada initiative. This is a national campaign that's helping Canadians to learn a little bit about dementia and then turn that understanding into simple actions that can improve the everyday life of people with dementia. We need to create dementia-friendly communities that are accepting of people with dementia. Think about some of the ways that you could gently assist someone in your community who you notice is having some difficulty. As dementia progresses, it's harder and harder for people to carry out their daily routine. But there is much that we can do as individuals to help people to maintain their sense of confidence and their sense of well-being. We must support people through programs like Dementia Friends and dementia-friendly communities, and through programs offered by the Alzheimer Society that you've heard about today. Programs like memory cafes in New Brunswick that we heard about, Minds in Motion, Art Therapy, First Link, medical alert safely home to help people who might go missing to return home safely. So that people with dementia are able to live in their communities as safely as possible. We're not stigmatizing them, we're not ignoring them, but we're rather making them feel included and part of our communities. So I would say there's four things that we can all do as individual Canadians. We can become a dementia friend, and we can help fight stigma. We can help our communities to become more dementia friendly. We can learn what the warning signs are about dementia. There's eight warning signs at the Alzheimer's Society of Canada. You can look on our website, learn a little bit more about the disease. And I would also say another important thing, support and participate in research, because we know we want more money to go to research, but research requires people to be involved in research in order to be successful. So thank you.
Thank you. Linda, I think you wanted to enter this, so I'll go to you first.
Okay, well, she already pointed out a couple of points that I want to make, but I'll make two. One of them is the issue, again, getting back to the complexity. I think, and this is the issue around that we have to stop looking at our bodies as machines to be fixed. When you get older, you get older. You get things. Your knees don't move as fast. You might not be able to see as well. And it gets back to the silos. If I go see one person that's only looking at my eyes, they'll just fix my eyes. If I go somebody else and so on and so forth until I become a machine that's going to be fixed. And then the costs go up and they go up and they go up and they go up. And I think we need to stop and think, what are the things that are preventing that person from having the quality of life? What are the things that they can live with and have that conversation, make informed consents and decisions in partnership with the healthcare team, of course, and looking at that there's things that you need to fix now and do now to prevent them later on. We need more data as looking at those trajectories. But if we look at machines to be fixed, as they say in French, on n'est pas sorti du bois, we will be giving up money over and over and over again. The other thing that I wanted to, I had the opportunity recently, and it has to deal with ageism, and so of course the issue around youth will come up again, because I think it has been shown and it's been documented that, you know, getting the contact early on. Ageism adds to dementia. It becomes, it's also been shown that it's not necessarily the younger individuals that are the most ageist. The older individuals are also very much ageist. And so I have had the fortune recently to go to the United Nations and to work with a group called the International Longevity Center Canada, ILC Canada, to push for a UN convention on the rights of the older person. And when I started looking at the rights, and this is not my background, so I had to look into it a little bit more and look at the rights, the human rights and the rights that children have. And when I started thinking about dementia, I started thinking maybe we need to think about this, and Canada, of course, would be in a wonderful country to bring this UN Convention on the Rights of the Older Person. the right to keep my family close and in contact with me, think about long-term care, think about how we split couples up, the right to unlawful interference with my privacy, the right to live in an appropriate milieu, the right to obtain periodic review of the treatment that is provided to me, my protection from the overuse of narcotic drugs, my right to be free of financial exploitation, and my right to be protected from degrading treatment. These are rights that are protected for children and not for seniors. And they are in the Declaration of Human Rights, of course. But the problem is ageism comes into play, and then this is what happens. So if we look at dementia, and there are papers out there that look at a rights-based approach to dementia. And when we look at inclusion, we are individuals first. Some of us happen to have dementia.
Thank you. Anybody else on the panel want to come in on this?
Can I ask a
No, go ahead.
Okay, can I ask a quick question? I agree with all the thoughts. I like to sort of take some of these thoughts and envision them as far as specific programs or services are concerned. Things like memory cafes, I think, are wonderful. I've also heard about a
Blue Umbrella program.
Where, you know, services can be provided in a sensitive way to people with dementia. Is that kind of thing spreading? Is it working? The other thing I want to ask about is that when it comes to assisted living facilities, the idea of a dementia village came out of the Netherlands. Is that something that is being pursued here or worth pursuing here? Are these ideas... projects worthy of further advancement?
Debbie?
I think there's a number of good programs that are available around the world that have got research behind them, and there's good evidence behind them. So I think I would caution us to say that let's make sure that anything that we invest in Canada has got good evidence behind it from either other, you know, good research that's been done or other parts of the world. So I'm aware of what you're talking about in the Netherlands, and I think there is some pockets of really good programs that are like that are here in Canada. But again, going back to the need for a national dementia strategy, there is no one place that pulls all of this together. All of these good little pieces of work that are happening everywhere, we need a way to bring it all together and make sure that we are implementing programs that have good evidence and research behind them.
Thank you. Okay, now before I go to the audience, we do have one member of the panel who is the reason we are all here, of course. And he's been very quiet, observing all the knowledgeable people telling us what really to do and what to expect and so on. And I'd like to give Michael Duncan, if he would like, an opportunity to say something to us.
I have it. I don't like to know that I have it, but I have it, and I expect, and I'll say yes, I'll have it, and don't try to get away from it. It seems like every little town or big town, have y'all got their own different things of how they're gonna beat or just sort of cope with it. With them, and for the last two years, I've tried every one of them as much as I can, and everybody's got all of these have got their own little how I'm going to do this and that and where it goes. And the home thing has its problems because they're from what we have seen what you get for a company to come in and do a little bit of cleaning of your home. It's too up and down all over the place. No, you get one good one this week, and next week it's a bad one. And you're driving, and it's important. Okay, when you got it. far as the I am in a big, supposedly big I go and do the thing.
It's always a guessing game at trying to figure out what we want to talk about.
I go and
sports.
No, I go and let them take blood out of it.
Yes.
You know, everything that seems to be a pretty good thing, but it's there with that. But
good memory testing. Frank.
No.
Okay.
And I went and did it. Do my thing. I think there's everybody's scared. Everybody seems to be scuttering around in their own things and not putting it all together.
Yes.
That's what I see this group of people. It would be very great to put everything together. What comes. But I think you've got to move quickly. And I hope you have to try and get everybody sitting in the same boat, right, to really get something going. I didn't say that, so that they need it. But it's going to be so. It looks like it's going to be very difficult to that. From here I am, just a little sailor. what I see all in this, if you can put together a thing of whatever that will be everybody seeing the same thing as much as possible that they can. I think that's the best pathway to cut down on all this, because it seems to be everybody's going in their own different way.
Right.
So you want everyone in the rowboat the same way.
Yeah. I think it'd be better. You would get better result for the money we have. But it's nobody really knows what's going on here. And if you come up with a general, here's how we got to do this to you, unfortunately, but have a little bit of that from what I'm saying, and see if that I'm also into the work that my friend over there.
Research with memory.
With
memory clinic.
Banging away on that, and it's gives me a little bit of, hey, that's what we need.
Good. Well, Michael, I think you've focused on so well on an area that we've identified in a number of our studies in healthcare, and this one in particular, where we have no way of dealing with best practices that are identified across this country. We do not have a health system.
That's holding you up. Holding you up.
Absolutely.
Than anything else.
Absolutely.
What you're doing here is trying to at least gather it around in Ontario. Okay. Here's the thing. But can you get the rest of Canada?
Well, that's right, and that's why. We agree with you 100%, and we recommended that we've got to find a way. That's why we recommended that the PHAC, Public Health Canada, that they should be, they have a mandate, in fact, that encompasses this, and that we need to be able to collect the best practices that are identified across this country and put them in a location the Canadians will know to go to find them. Another side of this is that we are described, not only by ourselves, but by those looking at us in this country, as a country of pilot projects. And we don't even have a mechanism of identifying and analyzing those pilot projects and identifying the best practices that come out of those and making them available across the country. So you're absolutely, an absolute example of what is the major issue. And thank you for that, Michael. I'd now like to open our meeting to a question and answer portion from the audience. And we invite you to pose a question to any member of the panel you would like or to raise a point for reaction. When you do approach the microphone, please state your name, the organization you're representing, if in fact you are representing an organization, and if indicate if you would like to direct your question in the first instance to a particular panel member. So, with that, I'm throwing the meeting open to the audience. Mimi?
Thank you very much. My name is Mimi Lowy-Young. I'm the former CEO of the Alzheimer's Society of Canada and a health systems strategic advisor. That's my current role. First of all, Senator Ogilvie, I want to commend, like everybody else has, for your excellent report. It is outstanding. It raises the issues once again. For me, the critical point here is how do we move this forward? We don't need any more reports. We don't need any more figures. We don't need any more studies. Dementia is an issue in Canada that we need to deal with. We need to deal with it. We need to get on with it. We need to start to implement. Strategy, plans are all great. We don't want this report to be seen as another one that's going to go on a shelf and looked at and ultimately implemented. So implementation or execution is one of the biggest issues around this, and I think something that we need to move on very soon. Dr. Hakim talked about this is an investment, not a cost. The costs are escalating. For me, the biggest issue is that you talk about best practice. Yes, I think that's absolutely essential. There is so much good work being done across the country, as Debbie alluded to. There is tremendous amount of research, but how do we turn best practice into practice? How do we ensure, and this is to the both Linda and Frank and Tony, how do we move from best practice to real practice that will make a difference and hold professionals accountable for practicing the way we expect them now that we know what the best practice is? Thank you.
I think Frank first. So Frank,
take this one on. Thank you. I think the point that Debbie made before about evidence base is really important. There are a lot of quote-unquote best practices out there that are not, in fact, best practices. So we do need to be very, very careful to ensure that whatever body looks at these has the scientific rigor to be able to sort of get through the weeds and find the really leading best practices. We also have to be careful because health services or health systems research is very different when it moves from one system to another. So it may work well in one country and not another. So it really needs to be filtered and vetted very carefully. The other thing we might need to look at is whether academics get too much credit for doing pilot studies, whether we need to look at a different sort of academic credit system where pilot studies are really not, you know, are only valued if they lead to the next study, because there certainly is a lot of academic incentive to do small study after small study after small study. You're often rewarded for the number of publications, not one hugely impactful publication would not be weighted as much as 100 that have no impact at all. So we might want to look at, you know, what's continuing this situation. Those are my two quick observations, but I'll try to think on the fly as we keep going around.
Linda.
Yeah, you were put on the spot there. I think we talked about silos within disciplines, but I think the other silo, Mimi, is between academics and policymakers. And we've talked about it a lot, and, you know, it is certainly center stage. As an academic, you definitely, you know, that is first and foremost. But I think we need to push it a little bit further. And so when we look at, for instance, the CCNA that's in your report, that, you know, like maybe now we're looking at if you put in for a grant, for instance, in CIHR, now you have to hook up with somebody who's in the CCNA, so we make sure that it fits in within that big, you know, envelope of dementia. But we need to make sure that, because there is translation knowledge, as you know, there's a lot of that, there's work that has been done, and there are reasons why people don't put things into practice. Sometimes they don't know about it, but sometimes we know they know about it, but they don't feel the we need to work with the professional associations to make sure that the best practices are part of their accreditation. We need to work with, you know, the leadership in the health institutions to make sure that they make sure that these practices are put into practice. So once we know that these systems, so we need places centrally where we can put all this stuff. We need to have people vetting it to make sure that the data is there, it's solid. Yes, we need to go beyond the pilot studies, but that means money for research, because when you're looking at a randomized controlled trial and so on, you're looking at bigger studies. So we need to bring people together. There are steps that have already been put towards that, but now we also need to work with the leadership in the institutions. We need to work with looking, and it's a whole science of looking at knowledge translation. We need to bring that forward and look, why aren't people putting things into practice? It's not necessarily because they don't know what they should be doing. Sometimes it's not legislated.
Tony, do you want to?
There are many practices that we need to bring in. And, you know, when you work with governments, it's just the way our system is. I don't mean this as a criticism. They often are interested in showing returns for whatever investments they're going to make within their mandate, which makes it very difficult to take the long view for things. But we know that there are some practices that do work. When we wanted to raise awareness about stroke, working with the Heart and Stroke Foundation, you have all seen the ads on TV, you know, how to recognize the symptoms of stroke. So that was an investment. So there are partnerships that will allow you to then raise the awareness. Dementia script starts in grade school. We need to appreciate that our children sometimes acquire habits that are not very conducive for good brain health as they get older. And there is lots of example of things that we can do. My point is that every stage of our development can be manipulated to try to decrease the risk for dementia as we get older. And so don't forget the school systems. We can work with them. Don't forget what Quebec did, which is not allow a fast food outlet to close to a school, so that when the school cafeteria offers you healthy food, you don't run away to the next fast food outlet. But these are the sorts of things that you mandate, not expecting to see immediate returns, but outcomes later on down the road that are very important. And we've got to keep that in mind. What is the average number of screens that a young person has these days? 4. And when mom says goodnight, sweetheart, and kisses you goodnight and closes the door, turns the lights off, a very large percentage of these kids are back up with turning on their screens, and they have much less good sleep and shorter periods of time. Some of the schools that allowed children to come to school later in the day have reported enormous benefit. So these are the inputs that we need to bring together to develop a national program. Don't underestimate the fear that many of our municipalities and even governments have, forgive me for saying this, of being embarrassed for not having done the right thing. That's not something you want to do very often, but the fact that you have the information may actually lead to better policies and better outcomes. Debbie.
Thank you. So the Alzheimer's Society of Canada is a key funding partner, along with the Canadian Institutes of Health Research and the Canadian Consortium on Neurodegeneration and Aging, which is a collection of 370 Canadian researchers across the country. So very, very important initiative that has been undertaken by the government. We haven't talked very much about research today, but I would say research is one of the three key priorities that we have set up and have to be part of a national dementia strategy. And I think your report verifies this as well and calls for 1% of the cost of care is really what we should be spending on research. So that comes to about $100 million a year. So knowledge translation and exchange, which Dr. Garcia brought up, I think is very important and germane to this conversation because, again, Dr. Molnar talked about the, you know, sometimes evidence is not well translated in other contexts. So if you look at the three important parts of knowledge translation, it's evidence. So, yes, the evidence has to be there. It's the context, which also often can be very different from place to place. So we do have to pay attention to that. And then it's how it's that the exchange of that knowledge is facilitated, so how it's actually brought into practice. And just a small example of that is when we worked with the Public Health Agency of Canada to bring the Dementia Friends program to Canada, which was initially started in the UK. The first thinking was that we just take the program and move it to Canada. And here's a perfect example of something where the context in the UK was totally different from the context in Canada. So we have to be very mindful of that. So even when evidence is there, we have to be mindful of the context in which the programs will be delivered.
Thank you. Okay, next question.
Hi. My name's Catherine Grand. My mom is 79 today. She's had Alzheimer's for 11 years. And I'm too old to have a 79-year-old daughter. So when you were saying before, what were you saying, can we put the daughter back into, what did you mean by that? And how do I become a daughter again? Because I'd really like to be a daughter again. Also, I've got a lot of comments here, so bear with me. Debbie, you were speaking about supports for caregivers. When my mom and me went to learn of her diagnosis, we were just told, you have Alzheimer's. Out the door, that was it. And sent home, and we had nothing. We had no support, and nothing. This was 11 years ago. I mean, we could barely look it up on the internet. And there was no memory cafes. There was nothing. We had nothing. So it was incredibly hard. And I just want to know, I'm really glad we've made so much progress, but I wish we had that kind of thing back then because it's been really hard. And when you were speaking about integrated healthcare, I think you need to include dentists and eye doctors in that approach. My mom needs a dentist really badly right now, and she can't sit still for 2 minutes. She needs some kind of dentist with dementia knowledge and an eye doctor with dementia knowledge. So that kind of thing needs to be looked at as well. And paramedics, she had to get stitches because she had a fall. Paramedics need to know how to handle dementia patients. Everybody needs to know. And about removing the stigma, I don't know what to do. People are scared. They don't want to look at it. They don't want to see Alzheimer's. My family, I'm sorry, family, if you're watching. I put it on Facebook, so you might be watching. But you don't go and see her, and she's there. You like the Facebook photos I put up of her when I go and visit her, but you don't go and see her. So it's them too. So it's everybody. And I mean, her brother and her sister-in-law goes and sees her, and her cousin and me. And she's got a big family. She's in a long-term care home, yeah. And she took care of everybody. She's a good person. She's a sweet, kind, gentle soul. And she doesn't have a mean bone in her body. And she deserves more. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Linda, do you want to put the daughter back in that equation?
I'll try. You know, when I was talking about thermometers before, about how are we going to know that we're doing this right, we talked about strategy. We're going to be doing it right when she can come up here and say things are good. That's going to be our thermometer. And so when we look at that, I mean, there's a lot. You know, the reason why I wanted to talk about daughter is, and thank you so much for sharing your story, because I think what it really speaks to the point I was trying to make, which is, you know, this is my mom, and I don't want to be her caregiver. And I'll do it because I love her and I want to do those things. And we need to understand that. And as we move forward and start looking at, we talk, you know, I mean, there's been so much discussion even about the word. You know, do we want to be caregivers? Do we want to be care partners? And do we want to be carers? Do we want, you know, like, it's like, frankly, if I knew that the person with, if I knew the caregiver wasn't going to disappear when we call them people living with dementia, I would include the caregiver in the person living with dementia, because that person's living with dementia, even though they don't have dementia themselves. And we need to find a way with all of the beautiful things that are out there, and I don't have an answer for you, but I think this is why we're all here, is to try to see, can we have a strategy that will allow us to pinpoint, and we will know, we need to hear from you, from people living, and we, you know, a lot of us do, and the idea is to try to say, did we get it right this time? If we give you this, so if we had some people, if we had a program, if we had great programs for home care, if we had the kinds of long-term care homes that we want, you would feel better to give that part away for the care, and then you could go back into being a daughter again, and using whatever your mom has still to do the kinds of things you used to do. And that's what I mean about keeping the daughter. But if we keep just looking at you as a caregiver and saying, good job, keep doing it, we're going to kill you.
So that's the only way I can fight. And
well, you've got a gang. Here. You've got your fighting, and you're fighting with a gang. We're behind you.
I'm glad. Thank you.
Frank and then Debbie.
I'm sorry to hear about your experience. Sadly, it's not a unique experience. It's a common experience. When I look at problems in healthcare, the question that comes to mind is, when good people do not do good things, what position have we put them in? And the way many of our dementia services have been funded by the ministries of health is for number diagnosed. When we try to do follow-up, we get our knuckles wrapped. We're asked, why are you doing all these follow-ups? The nurses will often back us up and do the follow-ups for us and call the families and solve the problems. But we really need follow-up to become a standard of care in all the ministries of across the country. We are allowed to follow up sometimes, but with no resources. So we have great people who are not doing great things, and we really need to look at what position have we put them in and how can we change that so they can operate properly.
And then we'll go to the next question.
I just want to say, Catherine, thank you so much for sharing your story. I hear your pain, I hear your frustration, and when you listen to a panel like this, we're talking about strategy, we're talking about the future. We're not necessarily helping you today with what you have to deal with.
I want the strategy.
I know.
I want law
Yeah. Good. Well, that's what we're working towards. So I just want to say behind all of this, I mean, I have a personal experience too. My mother passed away last summer with dementia. So behind what I'm doing is my passion for what happened in my own situation. Yes. So, you know, I hear your frustration. I just wanted to say thank you for sharing it.
Thank you.
Yes.
My name is Susan McCauley, and I write a blog called myalzheimersstory.com, and I also have a personal story to tell, and I think I can help perhaps and provide some information and maybe some ideas for you professionals to help you in what you're doing. So I lived in Dubai for 18 years, and in 2011, I gave up my life and I came back to Canada to care for my mom, who was diagnosed with dementia in 2006. And I think what happens with care partners is they get drafted into this role with absolutely no experience, no knowledge. You know, it would be like being taken to the airport and taken into a 747 and said, you know, go ahead and fly the plane. And there's, at the time in 2011, there were no, you know, I'm very internet savvy. I looked online. I could not find support at all. So in the past 6 years, I learned a lot about dementia and I learned a lot about caregiving. So I think that there are two, stigma is really important in the sense that it sets people up to fail from the very beginning as caregivers. And what is required, what the reason why people burn out, I know because I did burn out, is because they're unable, they don't have enough knowledge about the disease itself, and they're unable to deal with the behavior of the disease. So associated with the stigma or something we call, something that are labeled the behavioral and psychological symptoms of dementia, which in my opinion, after 6 years of experience and observation and my own research, I don't believe that those behaviors, responsive behaviors, as Dr. Frank said, they are normal behaviors. However, they're repeated and they're escalated and they're very difficult for the care partners to deal with because they're not educated as to what to do. So as a result, they end the situations escalate and everybody becomes very stressed. If the care partners were taught at the beginning of their caregiving journey how to manage dealing with people who are living with dementia, and they themselves are also living with dementia, that would reduce the stress levels for the care partners, both care partners, the people who have living with dementia, who have dementia, and those who are caring with them, and it would enable them to care for people for a longer period, thus they would be able to stay in their own homes for a longer time, and it would save a whole bunch of money. Another point that I wanted to talk about is the use of antipsychotic medications to sedate people who have dementia, who live with dementia. When I first went to care for my mom, I was unable to sleep at night because she was awake. So this means you get exhausted. I went to the family doctor. He gave an antipsychotic medication. I went to, then took her to her geriatrician. She got another antipsychotic medication, which at that point in time I didn't understand because I trusted the medical people. And so after a year, she was placed in a long-term care facility. And I used the word care, but it wasn't care at all. Very shortly after she went in, because of this belief that these behaviors are the result of dementia rather than the result of the environment and the way that care is delivered, then the people who are in the facilities get more sedated, which happened to my mom. And so she was on high levels of medication for 2 years. And I feel that this is really wrong. People need to be trained in how to actually care for people instead of warehousing and sedating them. So when you talked about jail, to me, that's the term I would use for the place that my mom was. And I believe that elder neglect and abuse are widespread in Canada, and in particular in Quebec, where the rate of prescriptions of antipsychotic medications are 1,300 prescriptions per 1,000 elderly population, which is double that of Ontario and New Brunswick, and four times that of the lowest provinces. So in my opinion, that's an indicator that there's widespread elder abuse throughout nursing homes in Quebec, of which my mom was living in one. I believe that there are people such as myself, so I have learned, I now give webinars, and I will be doing some seminars to help caregivers at the beginning of their journey to understand how to interact with people who are living with dementia so that everybody doesn't get as stressed as they do and the situations don't escalate and everything gets, you know, matters get made worse. So I think there's an opportunity for the Alzheimer's Society perhaps to draw on the expertise of people who have been caregivers before, who understand and know how to deal with the situation, to support other care partners to alleviate a lot of the difficulties and challenges that are in place for in-home caregivers. Thank you.
Before I open it up to the audience and or to our panel, I think you've given, Susan, you've given a powerful summary, and if we've got some specific things, I'll ask the panel to get back to them. But one of the things that we noted in our study on prescription pharmaceuticals in Canada, we did a four-part study, and the issue of over-medication is widespread throughout the entire medical spectrum, and it becomes pronounced in senior care and even more pronounced in the case of patients with dementia or those who have other issues that cause behavioral or motion issues. I'll put them together collectively. It is a major, dramatic problem, and I think the idea of the human rights of seniors, we know they are hugely violated in many areas, but this one in absolutely, it's a very serious situation. Members of the panel,
Just comment on that? I fought for 4 years to get my mother. She was both physically and chemically restrained, and I was not the one in legal control of her care. And I fought for 4 years against the long-term care facility that she was in. I went to court to try to get control of her care. And nobody believed me because I wasn't, you know, I'm not an expert. Well, I'm an expert now. And I know what I'm talking about, and I know what I've seen. And I've got audio, video, you know, I've got everything I need to demonstrate what happens. And it's really ugly. And when my mom went into care, I thought I was handing her to people. I didn't want her to go in. Again, I fought it. I thought I was giving her to people who knew what they were doing. But they didn't know. I knew more about how to deal with her, how to manage her, because I learned as I went. I knew more after a year than the people in the place knew, than the nurses that were teaching at the local college. So it's widespread elder abuse, and it's wrong. And you can't see it because nobody will report it. People like me who stand up, they tried to silence me. They threatened me with not being able to see my mom. They restricted the hours that I was going to see her. They did everything they possibly could to dissuade me. They made me take, I wasn't allowed to mention my mother's name in public. I couldn't talk about her. I couldn't have photos of her. I had to take 250 posts off my blog. Now, my mother died in this year, and I'm putting everything back up again, and I'm restarting my advocacy so that other people don't have to go through what I have gone through and what she suffered, which is a travesty. She didn't deserve it, as Catherine said. Our mothers, our elders don't deserve what's happening.
Thank you. Linda?
I think, again, thank you, Susan. I think it does. It speaks to several points. A couple of things jumped out at me. Again, I think when I was talking about long-term care, I think if we see it as home, as an extension of home, as a, you know, we're talking about things, again, I think as Debbie was saying, we're dealing with things at a high level here and that might not address specific issues. However, I think in our minds, if we start looking at long-term care homes as homes rather than hospitals, it might help us look at how to make priorities and where we make choices and the kinds of things that we want to have. One of the things that happens in there, it's an extremely regulated environment, and the staff has a lot, so I'm not excusing anything, and I know exactly what you're talking about. I'm sure that if we had a show of hands here, how many people here are caregivers or have been or whatever, probably the majority of people in this room would be raising their hands. So it's the regulation of it makes it sometimes that the people who do want to do good and do get it can't. And sometimes, you know, you have to give 2 baths a week. Well, you know, it's bathing is like one of the issues that's going to bring up behaviors. So the good news of it, I think, so one of the things is in moving forward, I think we need to bring in those examples to remind us that we need to start looking at them as homes. One, deprescribing is definitely an issue. It's one of the things that is being looked at very, you know, in lots and lots of details. Homes are being held accountable for, you know, how they're doing on that and where things are going. Sometimes they get pressure from families that they want them to keep them on drugs because, you know, they're having these behaviors. So they have to deal with that issue.
Can we,
there's an report.
Linda, I'm going to ask, I know there's at least one more questioner. Can I see a show of hands of others who may want to ask a question? We only have 12 minutes, okay? So I'm going to ask you to be focused, and panelists, if there is a directed question, please be brief in your answer. I think we're getting, I think we've had a number of very telling exposés. So you're next, and then would the person, whoever wants to come next, move up into the front seat.
Thank you very much for the time and the opportunity to ask a question. My name is Chris Dennis. I'm CEO of the Alzheimer's Society of Ontario. And I want to thank the steering committee or the standing committee on a great report, in particular your focus on dementia. I also want to thank you for your recognition of First Link in the report. And very quickly, for those of you who don't know what First Link is, it's really a primary care-driven program that allows doctors to connect newly diagnosed people and their families with the Alzheimer Society across Canada. And then we take over and we provide education programs for both caregivers and people with dementia. We introduce family to individual and family counseling, caregiver support, connections to other community groups, and so on. Basically, we take the person with dementia from diagnosis right through to end of life. Now, the reason I bring this up is that, you know, many of you are aware of First Link, but not everybody is, and that's part of our job. But in the report, it's mentioned as being available in several societies. It's actually now available. It's one of those pilot programs you mentioned that really did go viral. It's now available in all provinces across Canada in over 60 societies. And it's very, very well integrated. But there are variability. There is variability in terms of funding that's available. Now, my point is that some of these programs are working very well. And in the case of First Link funding, our funding is actually the same as it was 10 years ago, and yet the amount of intake that we're having has doubled. So First Link registrations have doubled in the last 5 years only, and yet our funding is almost exactly the same. So as these recommendations evolved into actual practical applications, one of the recommendations that we would have is to make sure that the existing programs that are actually working are fully funded or robustly funded so that we're not reinventing the wheel before we start a new project or yet another committee, as Mimi indicated earlier, before launching into new and entirely new things. So that's kind of my point. So the question for the standing committee really would be, is there a process of prioritizing all your recommendations and making sure that we don't start new things before we fully funded the existing programs that are working? Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, it's now clear that we're not going to have time for long answers, so I want to get the questions on the record. So I'm going to ask you to come up and put your questions, and we'll get all the questions on the record so that we can prioritize these afterwards and try to move forward.
Sure. Hi, my name is Saskia Sivananthan. I'm a health systems researcher, and I'm currently consulting for the WHO on their dementia strategy. And I actually had a quick question. First of all, thank you very much for your Senate report. It was very comprehensive. My question for you is when you develop a national dementia strategy, Canada is a very decentralized health system. So provincially, there are multiple strategies that already exist. And so how are you looking at integrating and supporting the operationalizations of those strategies along with this dementia strategy? What would be the value add that you can demonstrate at a national level? Thank you.
I'm going to answer that in detail, but that's a superb question, one we wrestle with and one that is an essential part of a national strategy to solve. Absolutely. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Riley Furoy. I'm here with the Alzheimer's Society of Canada, and I actually have a question from one of our Facebook followers, and it's in regards to young onset dementia specifically. So we know that a diagnosis of young onset comes with its own unique challenges. These people might still be working, they might have dependent children, they might still be caring for their own aging parents, and they also have significant financial commitments, such as maybe a mortgage or their children's education. But right now, there is a lack of available programs and resources and support that is adapted specific to their needs. So the question is, how will a national dementia strategy address the unique and complex needs of Canadians diagnosed with young onset dementia? And then also as a follow-up to that, how can we support people with dementia to stay in the workforce as long as possible?
Absolutely. Those are tremendous questions.
Sure.
We identified a number of those. Those are a key part of the strategy as well. And I'll answer it over. Senator Watt.
You can. Thank you, Honorable Senators, colleagues, giving me opportunity. Thanks for the invitation. First of all, I'm from the very isolated communities, remote communities, which have a very little service in the community itself when it comes down to the point of medical service of any kind. By starting off that, I have been living with my wife. Matter of fact, we had a 53rd anniversary not too long ago. And I've been living with this a disease that my wife has over 10 years. And she was diagnosed, I believe, within that time, around 10 years ago. And even though that I always have suspect that she might have something, because the way she behaved, the way she do things, I known about it since she was 50 years of age. Today, she's 70 years old. I have to make a move, and I wish I had not, but I had no choice. You know, the North is isolated communities, very small population in the community, and it's hard to come by a reliable people that they can be caretakers. And I have gone through numbers, huge numbers, with no real satisfaction in terms of finding out that they have some training, and they had no training. I tried all age. I tried at the beginning an elderly people, which I thought maybe they know something about it more than I do. Then it turned out they did not. I guess in old days, people never really noticed whether a disease that those individual people have, and they had no understanding of why some of those people have departed from us, from their loved ones. And they take their own journey. And unfortunately, we do need help in the Arctic. Not only in Nunavik, Nunavut, Nunatsiavut, including the Northwest Territory. We have nothing, absolutely nothing. When it comes down to the point of seeking information and trying to have a better understanding what you're dealing with, the dealing that you have with your loved one is not there. You look around, you go through the internet, you go through the whatever the information that might be available. Then I learn that there is a various number of Alzheimer's Society groups, which I started doing some study of on them to see whether I can get reliable help from those people. Before I got to that point, because I had no intention at the beginning to bring my wife down south, just before Christmas, 2 weeks before Christmas, I had to make a move. When I was in Ottawa doing my work as a senator, at times I have to leave my wife behind. Never in my life have I ever gone through the house that is empty house, which I'm going through now, which I'm experiencing now. It's a lonely world that you probably, most of you people know, especially when it happens to your loved one, the one that you always rely on for many things. But now she is in the professional caretakers, looked after by facilities in Montreal. She doesn't talk. For some reason, she has decided not to talk. She say words. She have no difficulties pronouncing certain things and so on, but she have given up talking or trying to talk to people. This is what I have to live through. And I noticed there was one question that I would like to ask senators, colleagues, which Linda have raised, legislative base. At times, when you don't have a legislative base, it's pretty hard to move things forward. This is what I have learned being a senator over the last 32 years. I've been here for 32 years. I was appointed by Pierre Elliott Trudeau on this last day. I guess what I'm looking for is the North needs some kind of recognition. I don't know what that is. Is that a legislative base? Should I try to move in the directions of a system to recognize the fact the North is so far from the South? High cost of living, high cost of transportation. Our purchasing power in my community, which is the closest one to the South, is only represent 25 cents. So how can some of my people, the Inuit that is, be able to afford and look after their loved ones when there is financing is not available? This is the one question that I keep putting myself into, and I don't get answers for myself. So I need help in that area. Thank you very much for allowing me. And then again, the issue that I raised, a legislative base. Think about it. How do we go about putting up pieces together? I think it's an important, and I think we need to move in the directions of at least not only what should be happening. I have a pretty good idea what's happening in Canada. I know what's missing, because I've been talking to a number of people and so on. But in the North is an area that I think we need to consider very seriously of building a component of that report and to make it sticking out so the system can do something about it. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Well, thank you, and thanks to everyone, our panel members, the audience. I think that one of the things that we can say absolutely is that everything we've heard here today is totally consistent with what we heard throughout our study and emphasizes and adds to and gives more dimension and examples of the issue and the challenge that we face in this tremendously important area, health area. And it gives absolute emphasis on the need for the major recommendation of a report, and that is a national strategy. Our report contains a number of references to documents that have very significant aspects of what needs to be included in a national strategy. But it has to be put together as a national strategy. And we are not good in this country at national strategies in any area. And for a number of the reasons that have been mentioned today, most of which is we are a balkanized federation. And that is a very difficult structure to deal with in terms of national strategies. But we have got to reach into this current century and deal with this and to bring the benefit to our citizens that is absolutely essential. Now, we know there are a number of different numbers floating around, and the numbers are useful in the sense that they do illustrate the size of this issue. We know that we hear numbers in the vicinity of 750,000 Canadians currently suffer with dementia, and that will almost double by the year 2030. Now, those are numbers, but you have heard today, and we have heard and mentioned in our report, what that means to Canadians. It's not just those numbers. It's everyone. Dementia affects everyone in our society. Everyone is touched by it. And it is an issue of age. We know there's early on, very early onset, as early as youth. But in the area of the age 70, we know it's somewhere in the vicinity of 10% of Canadians. But by the time you get in the early 80s, it's gone up to 40 to 50%. This is a very significant issue. And again, I repeat the issue of it affects everyone. I'd like to give another example from our hearings from a witness in terms of how we have to change our mind in thinking about even the ordinary things we think we do in society. One of our witnesses with dementia said, I reached the point where it wasn't safe for me to drive to a medical appointment. So in my city, the city in Ontario, we have a handy bus. You know what those are. They're designed, you call, and you'll be transported if you have a handicap to a center. So I called, she said. And I had to answer a number of questions. It was my first call. And one of the questions was, can you walk 100 feet? And she said, well, yes, I think so. Well, then you don't qualify to be picked up by a handy bus. The mentality is entirely a physical handicap. But she said, but I may not find my way to where I'm going or find my way back. We have to learn from these examples to not just the challenge we face overall, but to broaden our minds and how we deal and recognize and to bring those with dementia into our equation. Our report clearly states dementia patients and their caregivers must be critically involved in developing a national strategy overall. We have to hear, as we have heard today. So, it presents a challenge to all of us. It's a whole of society challenge. And we cannot hear years from now that they're still asking the same question. We do need to get on with developing a national strategy. And your committee, Senate committee, is pushing every lever it can to move this issue forward. And this event is just another of the ways. This is going to be a powerful meeting in terms of the recording of this meeting. Dementia is far and wide, and Canada's response needs to be just as far-reaching, if not more. Et j'espère que nos discussions vont aider les Canadiens.
And I hope our discussions will help Canadians to better understand the challenges that are linked to dementia.
And will help us find solutions. These solutions
will help bring comfort to people suffering from this illness, I would also like to thank everyone who took part in this event today. Your presence here was very much appreciated.
We help Canadians better understand the disease, the challenges it presents, and stir ideas to bring comfort to people who are living with this disease, who are caring for persons with this disease, and building their communities to recognize the critical objective that this must be. Thank you all for taking part in this event today. That concludes our meeting.